गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन एंड वेलकम बैक टू आवर चैनल। आई एम ट्विंकल पात्रा फ्रॉम IIM लॉ कॉलेज एंड करंटली अ लीगल इंटर्न एट लेक्सिस एंड कंपनी। एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द हिंदू माइनॉरिटी एंड गार्डियनशिप एक्ट। सो दिस एक्ट केम इन द ईयर 1956 एज पर द हिंदू कोर्ट बिल एंड इट एक्सटेंड टू होल ऑफ द इंडिया एंड इट केम टू एक्सटेंड द रूल्स ऑफ गार्डियनशिप एंड गार्डियन एंड वार्ड्स एक्ट। So, section 1 to 5 deals with the applicability and overriding and definition, etc. And these are so basic section, and you can read them by your own. In brief, I can tell you that applicability of this act, the act applicable to all the Hindus and not to Muslim, Christian and Parsis. And if you want to know more about the applicability of this act, I have done the earlier video of Hindu laws. You can watch my earlier videos and you will came to know the applicability of this act as well. Now I will start from section 6, that is natural guardian of a Hindu minor. Section 6 tells us that who will be the natural guardian of a Hindu minor. So in case it is a boy or an unmarried girl, then the father will be the natural guardian. But if the father is not alive or father is not there, then the mother will be the natural guardian. And also if that child is below 5 or of 5, then that mother will be the natural guardian, right? Next came that if that girl is married, then the husband will be the natural guardian. And if there is an illegitimate girl or an illegitimate boy, then the mother will be the natural guardian. And the act also says that if someone has left the Hindu religion or has been converted to any other religion or has renounced the world, then in that case he or she will not be the natural guardian of that particular child. Now let's come to section 7. It says natural guardian of an adopted son. So who will be the natural guardian of the adopted son? It will be the adopted father. And if there is no adopted father or he is dead, then there will be the adopted mother. Also, I just forgot to tell you that in section 6, the stepmother and stepfather are not included. They are the birth mother and birth father. Now let's come to section 8. It gives power of natural guardian. Tells us that what are the powers of the natural guardian. So a natural guardian cannot mortgage, charge or transfer by sale, gift or exchange or otherwise any property of the immovable property of the minor. So without the prior permission of the court, a natural guardian cannot do these things, like he cannot mortgage, charge or transfer the immovable property of the minor. If he will do that, that will be voidable to the instance of the minor. And he cannot lease the property or the part of that property, but he can lease the property if the minor the age of the minor is less. He can lease that property for 5 years, like if the minor is of 10 years, so he can lease the property for 5 years. But if the minor is of 16, so he cannot lease that property for 5 years, because in the next coming years the minor will become major, then it will be invalid. Now this fourth clause of the section also says that the court will give permission only when it will be in the welfare of that child. And if the court will think that yes, it is necessary, then only the court will give permission to the natural guardian. Otherwise the court will also not give permission. Now let's come to section 9. It says testamentary guardian and their power. So it tells us that who are the testamentary guardian of the particular child. So if the father died and in its will he has mentioned that X will be the guardian of the particular child after my death, but if the mother is present or alive, then X will not be the guardian, mother will be the guardian, right? But if the father died and he mentioned that X will be the guardian, and if the mother is dead, then in that case the X will be the guardian. Next, third case is that if father died and he writes that X will be the guardian in his will, and also mother died and she writes that Y will be the guardian in her will, then Y will be the guardian, not X. So there are three cases. I hope you understand that if father appoint X and mother is alive, then mother will be the guardian. If father appoints X and mother is dead, then in that case X will be the guardian. If father mother both died and father mentioned X, mother mentioned Y in their will, then Y will be the guardian. And the testamentary guardian will have the same power as the natural guardian. Now let's come to section 10. It says incapacity of minor to act as guardian of property. It means that one minor cannot you know cannot come as a guardian of the another minor's property. He cannot be the guardian, a minor cannot be the guardian of another minor's property. Section 10 says that. Now let's come to section 11. It says de facto guardian not to deal with minor's property. It means that if someone is a de facto guardian, on that ground he cannot say that I can deal with the minor's property, or can sell, can exchange, can mortgage. He cannot say that either if he or she is a de facto guardian. De facto guardian means that he is not a guardian by will or by court or by any will, but he is caring, he is taking care of that child by his own will, or then he or she will be the de facto guardian. No one has said them to, you know, guard the child or take care of the child. By their own will they are doing so, then in that case they will be the de facto guardian. But section 11 says that de facto guardian will not have any right on the property of that child. Now let's come to section 12. It says guardian not to be appointed for minor undivided interest in joint family property. It means that if there is a undivided property of that particular child in a joint family, then the adult of that joint family will divide that property and give that property to the minor. For that, basically for that thing, no guardian will be given to that particular child. Now let's come to the last section of this act. Yes, this act is very small, and the last section says that welfare of a minor to be a paramount consideration. It means that the first and foremost thing will be the welfare of the welfare of that child. Only then the guardianship will be given to any of the person. And clause 2 of this section says that if the court is also appointing the guardianship of a particular child according to this act, the court will also see that it is for the welfare of that child that the particular guardian is appointed for the welfare. If the court will think that this person cannot take care of that child, and if that person comes in this act also, then also the court can change its decision and can give guardianship to any other person that the court thinks fit. So that's it for this act, for this video. And this act was so small, I have covered all the parts. And if you have any doubt, you can comment me down below. And also keep liking, keep sharing, and subscribe to our channel.